Good evening. My name is Catherine Rouleau. I'm the director of the Global Health Program for the Department of Family and Community Medicine here at the University of Toronto. And it is my great privilege to welcome all of you to this very special event with Marshall Ganz. I want to start by acknowledging the other co-hosts of this event. They are Women's College Hospital, St. Michael's Hospital, the School of Public Policy and Governance at the University of Toronto, and Samara Canada, which is a community agency dedicated to political engagement in the Canadian context. Some of you might find it surprising that such a wide array of organizations are coming together around Marshall's presentation. And so I thought it might be worth highlighting at least three reasons why this is happening. As I've mentioned, a number of the organizations engaged today are actually a healthcare organization, two hospitals and one Department of Family and Community Medicine. For those of you who, for those of us who are healthcare providers, particularly family physicians, the notion of narratives is one that is familiar to us. We experience it at the individual level in our interaction with patients, and in fact, we weave our work through the narratives of our patient's story. And so it seemed appropriate to transition from an individual narrative to a collective narrative to see what we might learn from Marshall around that theme. The second aspect that I think will resonate with many of you, many of us here, is that health is fundamentally a political issue. It was Rudolf Virchow who pointed out that medicine was a social science and that politics was in fact medicine at a higher level. And so it seemed appropriate, again, to engage as a teacher, somebody who has a deep experience of political involvement and political engagement, particularly at the community level. And so we look forward to learning from that aspect. And thirdly, I think it's fair to say that the five co-hosts of this evening, if not organizationally, certainly through the individuals that work for them, and many of you here in the room, share a degree of, I would say, concern about the state of politics in our country and in our city. I think it's also fair to say that that many of us feel a need for a bit of a shakeup, for a deeper engagement in the political agenda and the political life of both our city, our province, and our country. And so again, with that in mind, it seemed appropriate to engage as a teacher and a collaborator, somebody with such deep experience of politics. And so on that, I'd like to introduce Professor Marshall Ganz. He's a senior lecturer in public policy at the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University. Marshall brings 50 years of wisdom as a builder of citizen engagement and a leader of social movement. His work, which focuses on leadership, organization, civic association, and politics, has been adapted and extended to work with the Sierra Club, New Organizing Institute, campaigns in climate change, immigration reform, healthcare practice, and much more. From labor organizing with the United Farm Workers and Cesar Chavez, to guiding the grassroots political organizing of President Obama's 2008 presidential campaign, Professor Ganz has developed a framework to build meaningful and effective movements from the local to national scale. A central piece of this framework draws from the deeply human practice of storytelling through narratives. Marshall Ganz's work is grounded in hard-learned lessons, but perhaps more importantly and more surprisingly, it is also rooted in a relentless hope for the future. And so it gives me great pleasure to welcome Marshall to talk with us today. Thank you.
Good evening. Is anybody out? Come on. Now let's try it again. Good evening.
Good evening.
All right, much better. Just checking. No PowerPoint, just conversation is what we're hoping to have here. Little Luddite. Well, anyway. It's a pleasure to have this time to talk with you, work with you this evening. I have to say, Catherine and company have been working me pretty hard today. I got introduced in the morning with the nurses and then in the afternoon with the Samar group and now here. No, it's good. And it's good for a couple of reasons. The first reason is Walter Brueggemann, a Protestant theologian, wrote a book he calls The Prophetic Imagination, in which he argues that transformational vision occurs at the intersection of two elements. One he calls criticality, which is a clear view of the world's pain, of its hurt, of its need, coupled, though, he says, with a sense of hope, of the world's promise, of its possibilities. And the two together are what create transformational energy. Pain without hope is despair, but hope without the motivation to act goes nowhere either. And so it's the way they come together, he argues, that inspires transformational energy and action. And a lot of the people in this room, whether health professionals, whether working with other communities, but I'm thinking especially of health professionals, confront the world's hurt daily. I mean, that's what your work is, if you're called to healing. And you have to be sources of hope daily. There's a lot of learning in that. And there must be a lot of challenge in that, but there's a lot of enormous potential energy in that, it seems to me. And so I think sort of linking that kind of transformational energy, but thinking of it as less as simply an individual thing, but how it can become a broader source of energy for change and transformation, I think is one of the things that's going on in the whole world of health around the world, whether it's in public health, whether it's in global health, and it's in community after community. And I see it in my classes at the Kennedy School, where now we have doctors show up, we have public health people show up, we have nurses show up. Never used to be the case before. And so there's a shift, and it's a really interesting shift, and I think an important one. The second reason that I'm glad to have this time to talk with you is Toronto. I was sent here in 1968 when I was working with the United Farm Workers with the mission of driving California grapes out of Toronto. And yes, because we were organizing grape workers in California and went on a strike. The strike was broken, essentially. So we had to figure out how to develop the economic power and the growers we needed in order to get contracts and to improve the conditions of workers. And so we decided to boycott grapes from California, ask people so that they couldn't sell them until they recognized the union improved the conditions. Turns out that Toronto is the third largest grape market in North America. Yeah, interesting fact, didn't know that. Montreal is the fifth largest grape market. So we were dispatched in 1968, okay, see if you can get those Canadians to stop eating California grapes. Well, we were received amazingly, and in the course of 2 years, managed to, Toronto became a grape-free city, believe it or not. There were these supermarket chains, Dominions, Loblaws, I mean, they don't exist anymore, I don't think. But what was really interesting was the opportunity to learn organizing in this context. And again, 1973 to 75. And what I find is that it's so important to get out of your own context in order to actually learn what works and what doesn't. And so this was a different setting. And I learned from your labor movement, I learned from your political organization, I learned from the faith communities that were enormously effective in their support for our work here in Toronto during those years. So anyway, I was glad to have the opportunity to come back. We had an office over there on Madison, just off Bloor and Spadina, I think it is. And so anyway, that's the second reason I'm happy to be here, is to sort of recognize what the benefit this city was for me. Okay, what we're going to talk about, so I assume I'm going to get a glass, a little drink of water here. We're going to talk about leadership for change, and we're going to talk a little bit about leadership as organizing. But I need to take a few moments to define what I'm talking about, because when you hear the word leadership, it's sort of like good. It can mean anything. And so many, you know, every time you hear somebody talk about leadership, they're talking about something else. So I want to be clear what I'm talking about. My understanding of leadership is rooted in three questions posed by a first century Jerusalem scholar, Rabbi Hillel, who, when asked, how do I consider how to act in the world, he responded with three questions. The first question, he said, these were questions to ask yourself. And the first question was to ask yourself, if I am not for myself, who will be for me? Now, that's not a selfish question. It's a self-regarding question. It's saying, look, if you presume to lead, then you better be clear about what you're about. You know, what moves you? What is it that you want from this? Because people are going to want to know that. And so you need to be clear about yourself. It's self-awareness as opposed to self-consciousness, you might say. But then the second question he said to ask yourself is, if I am for myself alone, what am I? Because to be a who and not a what is to understand that we exist in relationship with others in the world, and that our capacity to realize our goals is inextricably wrapped up with the capacity of others to realize theirs. We are relational creatures. And thirdly, he says, ask yourself, if not now, when? Which is not advice to jump off a bridge. But it is recognition of the fact that we can rarely learn how to do well what we want to do until we start doing it. You know, Jane Addams described what she called the snare of preparation. You know, just some more planning, just some more research, just another degree. Whoops, just another degree. And finally, I will be ready. Yeah, until the first day. I mean, and so the point is that the future is uncertain and action is uncertain. And so unless you can find the courage to act, you can't learn. And that's what I take from that third one. So for me, leadership is about the interaction of these three dimensions of self, of other, and of action, and how the three interact with one another. Now, the other important note here is that these are questions and not answers. He doesn't say, here's the answer. He says, ask yourself these questions. Now, why would that be? Well, when do you need leadership? Is it when everything's working? Everything's going fine, all the systems are operating. Is that when everybody says, where's the leadership? When is it? When? Yeah, when things are going wrong, when there's problems, when there's challenges, there's things that don't work. That's sort of the domain. And so it suggests that the domain of leadership is not about certainty, it's uncertainty. It's not about control. It's about engaging the unexpected in ways that in purposeful ways. And that's really kind of scary. You know, it's really kind of scary. It's a challenge to the hands. Do I have the skills I'm going to need to deal with this new situation? It's a challenge to the head. Can I figure out how to use my resources in new ways to deal with this new challenge? It's a strategic challenge. And then there's the question of how do I find the courage? How do I find the hopefulness? How do I inspire that in others? That's a challenge to the heart. So it's a way of understanding leadership as a multidimensional kind of practice, but a practice. And a practice as distinguished from a position or a person, okay? I think we all have experience with people in leadership positions, right? Positions of authority who turn out not to be exercising the best leadership. Has that ever happened? Maybe that doesn't happen in Canada. Is that, yeah. Yeah, I heard a loud ha ha. I heard, all right, got that point. Yeah, all right, that's good. But then we also know that if we work in communities or in work sites, in workplaces, that we find people who are exercising leadership all the time who have no formal position. And so what I'm trying to focus on is leadership as a practice, not as like, you know, that person was born to be a leader or not. A practice that can be learned. A practice that, in fact, most of us can learn. So not a position, not a person, but a practice. And that's kind of the idea. So my definition that I use for leadership is this. First of all, it requires accepting responsibility. That's a choice. You know, you got to accept responsibility for enabling others to achieve shared purpose. So this is enabling others. This is leadership as relationship. This is not leadership as performance. It's not leadership as command. It's not leadership as example. It's leadership as relationship. Engaging with others. It's not the diva theory of leadership, you know, where the leader is supposed to be the sun, and then if you get close, you get warm, or maybe too close, you get burned. Maybe that happens too sometimes. That's not it. It's leadership in this other way of working with other people to achieve shared purpose under conditions of uncertainty. And that's how we're going to talk about the practice of leadership for change. Because leadership for change is a response to a challenge, to some need for change, some need, some problem that has to be dealt with. Now, my introduction to this was in the context of organizing. And organizing is a particular form of leadership that doesn't begin by asking, what's my issue? It begins by asking, who are my people? Who are my people? What's the problem from their perspective? And how can I work with them to enable them to use their resources to develop the capacity they need to solve the problem? Now, they may need to use their resources to mobilize other resources. But the point being, it's about enabling others to work together to put their resources to work in a way that can solve the problems that are there. And so organizing then has that. And so it's not about providing services to clients. Okay, you know, the word client comes from Latin. Anybody know what it comes from? Come on, medical people are supposed to know about Latin. Come on. The inclinare, it means to lean upon, right? A client is one who leans upon. That's not what organizing is about. That's not what leadership development is about. And it's not about marketing a product to customers. You know, it's not about like an exchange. You know, I give you this and you give me that, exchange over with. That's not what it is. It's about engaging in relationships with people to transform a community into a constituency is the way I've come to think of it. And I know constituency has a special political meaning, but I'm using it in a broader sense. Again, I'm going to go back to the Latin here. Constituency comes from constare, which means to stand together. In other words, it's about enabling a community to come together, work together, stand together, decide together, act together in order to achieve its common purposes. And so that's how we're going to be approaching this work or this idea and how it works. And, you know, this idea of people coming together, working together, deciding together, that's not some new thing. It sure wasn't invented at the Kennedy School, God knows. The first time I came across it was, you know, in the book of Exodus, actually. I mean, where there's this story, this organizer guy named Moses, and there's these people, and they are having a hard time, and they got to mobilize and figure out how to get out of there and how to get on a path to a pathway to a land of promise for them. It's deeply embedded in a lot of faith traditions, this story. Or how about when the Greeks decided that they didn't need kings anymore? With no offense to the queen, I understand where we are. But that they could govern themselves, that they could govern themselves. What a radical, you know, and then it goes back to just the ways people have found to defend themselves over the years. You know, everybody know what a boycott is? What's a boycott? Yeah, not to buy. You know where it comes from? You know where it comes from? Boycott, the word boycott? Not in Latin. Hey, very good. All right, good. You got me. No, actually not Latin. Actually it comes from a feisty little island off the coast of England.
Isle of Man?
Not the Isle of Man, I'm sorry. Yeah, how about the Isle of Ireland? How about, no, here was the deal. There was a British landlord who had tenant farmers and no improvements and conditions were really awful. And so these tenant farmers decided that they were going to refuse his share of the produce until things got fixed, until things got taken care of. And it went on for quite a while, but eventually they won. His name was Captain Boycott. And that's kind of where boycott comes from. Isn't that kind of cool? Yeah. And my point is that people have been finding ways to act together to improve their conditions. So whether it's a faith tradition, a civic tradition, a popular tradition, all these elements kind of come together in this work of organizing. Now, my introduction to this tradition, and really the first time I seriously asked myself Hillel's three questions, was in 1964 when I was a junior at Harvard College and volunteered for the Mississippi Summer Project. And the Mississippi Summer Project was an effort to challenge the most hardcore state in the United States resisting desegregation and the rights of African Americans. and it was a program of bringing Northern students to Mississippi. And the problem was that the mostly African-American organizers in Mississippi, the state would stop at nothing literally, to stop them. And the idea was, one of the organizers put it this way, well, the law doesn't cover black people in Mississippi, but it might cover white people from the north, so let's bring the people the law covers to a place where there is none, and maybe it'll bring the law with them. It was a strategy. But we were gathered in Oxford, Ohio, at a college there in training to go south. The next day, we were timed to leave, and we got word that day that three of our party had disappeared, Michael Schwerner, Andy Goodman, and James Cheney. They had gone down a week earlier. They'd gone to a town called Meridian, been sent to a town called Philadelphia, ironically, to investigate a church burning, and had not been heard from since. And it was one of those things when everybody kind of knew, didn't know what happened, but knew what happened. I knew that we weren't going to see them again. So Bob Moses, there's that name again, Bob was the lead organizer of this effort, called us together in a room pretty much like this. And there's about 300 people in this room. And Bob said, look, I got to be honest with you. Our three brothers are probably gone. And I would like to be able to say, go home, forget it. It was a good idea. Forget it. But I can't. I need you to go. Now, if somebody has to leave, no shame. But I've got to ask you. Oof, that was one of those moments when you sink down into your chair and it's kind of like, what in the hell did I get into here? And it was silent. It was completely silent in this room. And, you know, you could think what people were thinking. For me, I was kind of reflecting on, my father was a rabbi. My mother was a teacher. We lived in Germany for 3 years after the Second World War. His work was mostly with Holocaust survivors. I met people who'd survived that horror looking for hope somewhere. My parents interpreted the Holocaust to me not as being simply about anti-Semitism, but about racism, and that racism kills. Very simple. Not complicated politics or ideology. Racism kills. We were trying to challenge that. Now, as a rabbi's kid, I don't know if there's any preacher's kids here, or are there any? I don't know. It's getting to be a pretty scarce breed, I guess. That's a whole other problem, but a whole other issue. But no, as a rabbi's kid, you know, you have to go to all the stuff, you know, all the different activities. You're also supposed to be perfect, which is a different kind of issue to deal with. But I loved the Passover Seders, because the Passover Seder was the telling of the Exodus story with food, which was kind of cool. And I liked that story, but there was a part where they would turn to the kids and they would say, you were slaves in Egypt. And they said, excuse me, I've never been to Egypt. I've never been a slave. What are you talking about? And it took me a while to realize the point was that that story was not the property of one people, time, or place, but was to be told generation after generation and challenge you to figure out, are you with, you know, Pharaoh and those guys and those horses and chariots, or are you with those people that are trying to, you know, find a land of promise? Well, civil rights movement spoke the language of Exodus. I mean, it really literally did. And as I looked around the room, you know, we were all like 18, 19, 20 years old. You know, and you know that Brueggemann thing, coming of age with a critical eye. That's what young people do, but almost of necessity, hopeful hearts. And so that room was silent until a woman named Jean Wheeler, who was an African-American organizer in the back, she stood up, she started singing. They say that freedom is a constant struggle. They say that freedom is a constant struggle. Oh, Lord, we struggled so long, we must be free. They say that freedom is a constant dying. We've died too long. We must be free. And as she stood up and began to walk out, everybody filed in behind her, and the next day, every single person went to Mississippi. Now, that was an important moment for me to reflect, to decide, and I'm so grateful for the choice that I made because it opened up a whole pathway of life for me. Because in Mississippi is where I discovered my calling. And I say calling, because I mean that in that sense, discovered a calling. And what was that? Well, you know, Mississippi, every measure of inequality, you could, you know, housing, healthcare, education, whatever, whites were here and blacks were here. I mean, that's just how it was. But it was also kind of clear that if you brought some medical supplies or you brought some books, or it wasn't going to change anything. It'd be a nice thing, you'd be a charitable person, Well, we began to learn something about the difference between charity and justice is much more demanding. Justice demands that you ask, that you're not satisfied with what's wrong, but ask, why is it wrong? Justice demands that you go deep and you say, how come all this inequality? And you start going into the how come all this inequality, and well, African Americans had no right to vote in Mississippi. Economically, the labor laws that protected other workers didn't protect agricultural workers and domestic workers. Culturally, I'd never had the experience going up to somebody twice my age who would stand up, call me Mr., introduce himself with his first name, not look me in the eye because he was black and I was white. And that went on thousands of times a day across the South. You put together the cultural and the political and the economic lack of power, and you begin to understand why. Power turns out to be the issue. Because who would choose to live that way? So why wasn't it changed? Well, it turns out that the people with the power, they were just satisfied with it just fine, thank you very much. And you'll often find, when you find these enormous inequalities, they're not just happenstance. They're not just happenstance. The people who are suffering from them turn out not to be able to do anything about them because there's other people who are resisting that. And it takes challenge and conflict and struggle to create change. Now, those are nice words to say. You know, we needed power. So some people said, go to Washington, D.C. That's where the power is. I don't think anybody would say that today, but that's another issue. But no, and so people go, yeah, hi, federal government, could you come in and help us here in Mississippi and you know, give us some of your power? And you know what it was? It was like, well, testify before our committee. Do some more research. We need more data. These things take time. So what became evident was that unless the people with the problem also became authors of the solution, nothing was going to change. It was all just going to be words. It was all going to be words and gestures. But the people with the problem don't have any power. So how do you get out of that? Well, we discovered there was a difference between power and resources. And we discovered that while communities lack power, they don't all lack resources. In fact, they may have resources that could be used to create some power. Well, what does that mean? Well, the event that taught and really launched the civil rights movement, I know you weren't expecting a lecture here on American history and civil rights movement, but there's some important lessons embedded. Who's heard of Rosa Parks? Oh, geez. Well, who was Rosa Parks? She was a lady who was one day tired and she wouldn't get up and give her seat. Was that who she was? She was secretary of the NAACP chapter. She'd been trained in organizing at Highlander School. She was arrested as a strategy. See, the people in Montgomery saw the Supreme Court the year before say desegregation of schools. Well, the buses there, blacks in the back, whites in the front, no man's land in the middle, armed deputized bus driver. If you were black, you walked past the armed deputized bus driver, the rows of white people. You found a seat, and if a white person wanted that seat, guess what? Stand up, give it to him. Going to work, coming home from work twice a day, what kind of anger would that make you feel? There was a lot of anger in that community about that. A lot of anger. So they said, maybe we can extend that ruling to the buses. But we're going to file a lawsuit and we need a plaintiff, and Rosa Parks will be a great plaintiff, and she's going to get arrested. And so she got arrested, and now we have the grounds for the lawsuit. But the women's committee at the black college there said that is not enough. We can't let her to go to jail by herself. We have to see if we can get the whole community to stay off the buses for one day on Monday. And they convinced Dr. King and the others. They leafleted the churches. They did all that stuff. And Monday morning rolls around, and the buses start rolling. And there's a great description of Dr. King up early in the morning looking at the buses. Is he going to see a black face? Not a single black face. And that community saw itself really differently at that moment. Wow, look what we just did. Look, we just stood together. Because one of the problems of powerlessness is you don't think you can stand together. You don't think you can act with solidarity and trust with one another. Well, that night then, they decided to turn it into a boycott. And they decided that they would just stay off those buses until the bus company changed its policy. Now, what's the point here? They discovered they thought they had to look up for power. They needed the courts and they needed all that. They discovered a different way to find power by looking down. What do you see when you look down? What part of your anatomy? Turned out everybody had feet in a community. And if you use those feet to walk to work instead of getting on the bus and everybody did it together, then the bus company wouldn't get your bus fare. And guess what? The bus company would be more dependent on the community than the other way around. And that's how they created their power. That's how they created power. Took them a year, they won. Now, the reason that galvanized the civil rights movement was lawsuits are one thing. Discovering that your feet can be a source of power, hey, everybody's got that. And so it was the way ordinary people could begin to imagine and create ways to use their resources to challenge this system. Students in North Carolina that had sit-ins in the restaurants where no black people were supposed to, they used a different part of their anatomy very creatively by sitting in places they weren't supposed to sit. My point is that that was pretty cool, that you could transform resources into power through collective action by understanding that systems of power always depend on those whom they exploit, which means you can always withdraw. Maybe costly. That was Gandhi's whole point about nonviolence, non-cooperation. And nonviolence is such a lousy word. Satyagraha, truth force, soul force, a form of struggle, not a not thing, but a thing. Understanding that kind of interdependence. Well, that was really exciting stuff. And you know, the people who organized it, Rosa Parks, Dr. King was a Baptist preacher. A guy named E.D. Nixon was a sleeping car porter, one of those guys that used to carry people, white people's baggage on the trains, on the overnight trains. Except he belonged to the first real major black union in the United States, Sleeping Car Porters Union. He was going all over the country learning about union stuff and coming back and those skills. So what emerged was, oh, there's this thing. It's called organizing. It's about developing leadership. It's about building community around leadership. It's about how communities can turn their resources into sources of power. And that was pretty exciting to me. That, wow, that's pretty cool. So it was time to go back to school in September. And guess what? Didn't seem so interesting. I'm afraid I wrote them a little letter at Harvard. I mean, I had my senior year to go. I wrote them a little letter saying, how can I go back and study history when we're busy making it? It was kind of arrogant. It was quite arrogant. I mean, it was, you know, it was college junior arrogant, you know, but with no offense to college juniors, but it was also true. And so I stayed in Mississippi for another year. And then when I was thinking of going back to school, I went back to California where I grew up in a town called Bakersfield, the southern end of the San Joaquin Valley. It's an oil and agriculture town that John Steinbeck made infamous through Grapes of Wrath, because that's where it took place. A man named Cesar Chavez had just started a grape strike 30 miles from where I grew up. Now, I grew up in the middle of that world, but I hadn't seen it. I had to go to Mississippi to get educated about race, power, and politics in America to go back home and see here was another community of people of color, also without political rights, also without economic protections. And guess what? California had its own history of racial segregation going back to the Chinese at the turn of the century. And as late as the 1950s, movie theaters in LA had Mexicans upstairs and whites downstairs. Maybe you didn't know that. It turned out that Mississippi was not an exception to America. It was an example of the America we needed to change. So I began working with Caesar, 1965, did that for the next 16 years up until 1981. And that's really where I learned the craft of organizing. I got the sort of the calling in the South, but the craft, the skills. You know, Caesar brought the guy who trained him, a guy named Fred Ross, who took us through the craft of organizing. You know, how many people came to your meeting? Five? How many did you expect? Eight. What happened to those three? How come they didn't show up? You know, what happened to that person you contacted last week? Did you follow through? I mean, the kind of rigor, the focus on every detail of a craft to achieve excellence in it. And what a great school that was, although I have to confess I was very resistant at first. But it sort of came to be, and because we had to learn to organize in the fields, we had to learn to organize in communities. We had to learn to organize. My first political campaign was Bobby Kennedy in 1968. We did the Get Out the Vote in East Los Angeles. Mexican immigrant farm workers who were not citizens, we went to East LA to mobilize the Latino vote in East LA, turned out precincts like 87%, unheard of in that primary election, unheard of. And we won the primary for him, but then he was taken from us that night. And then we got sent to places like Toronto where we had to learn how to boycott grapes and how to do all this sort of stuff. So it was a fabulous school for organizing, and it trained a lot of organizers. I'm very grateful for it. I left in 1981, did another 10 years of union issue and electoral work, mostly in California, and got invited then to my 25th reunion at Harvard. Now, I never graduated. This puzzled me a little bit. Why would you invite me to a reunion when I hadn't graduated? Well, there was this other dropout up in Seattle who had done rather well in his particular field. That wasn't me. Anybody know who I'm talking about? Bill Gates? Yeah. Yeah, he was a dropout too. Yeah, our paths took different directions. But I was feeling really stuck. And so I went to this reunion, and I ran into 20-year-old me. And so you know how sometimes you leave a part of yourself behind in places where you have intense experience? So 20-year-old me came up to me and said, sort of, how's it going? I said, I'm feeling really stuck. Reagan's been president for 8 years. I don't know what's happening here. And I need to figure out how to go deeper and broader. And so 20-year-old me said, well, why don't you come back and finish that senior year? You never finished. No, you could have a year of study and reflection and writing. So I don't know if my brain will work. And so I went to see one of the deans. Last day, turned out to be an Episcopal priest. If he'd laughed at me, I was so fragile, it would have been all over. He didn't. We talked for 3 hours. We discussed the fact tuition had changed a little bit in the intervening period of time. So in 1991, went back, wrote a senior thesis in history and government about declining political participation, for which I'd done the field work already, and graduated class of 64-92. And my 81-year-old mother got to come and see her son finally become a college graduate, so I was able to sort of close that particular loop as well. But I got the bug, and so then I went on to the Kennedy School to do a master's and then a PhD in sociology. And while I was working on the PhD, I was asked to design a course on organizing. Now, I hadn't been thinking I'm going to teach at Harvard. That's the last thing in the world, I thought. But they asked me to do this course on organizing, and it turned out that was a perfect place to integrate my life experience with social science in a conversation with a rising generation. And so the pedagogy became central to my learning. How to design ways people can learn these things, that get these skills, these crafts. And you know, going to class a couple times a week was like, oh, today you get to go have a conversation with the future. That's pretty cool. You know, talk about for my own learning, my fall class, I had students from 31 countries. You have a conversation with the world in a classroom. So the teaching became very central to my learning. And a lot of these frameworks and things we've been learning and trying to share about organizing come out of that experience. I've been on the faculty full-time since 2000. I teach a course on organizing built around practice in the spring, public narrative course, which is one piece of it. I'll explain in a moment in the fall. And for the last 5 years, I've been doing a distance learning class using WebEx as a platform to work with about 125 students in about 20 countries around the world on organizing. We do that in the spring. If anybody's interested, you can come to the website and you can sign up. But it's a 14-week class, and it's pretty exciting to learn how to use the new media, the technology to create a global learning environment, which is what we've been doing there. So the last thing I'll say about this bit is that I wound up getting back into action. You know, say university is an ivory tower. Well, it is if you let it be. But, you know, I discovered that teaching organizing was like another program of leadership development. I mean, it was recruiting, actually, to the truth be told. And it turned out that students went off and did things, you know what? Like the Howard Dean campaign, 2003 in New Hampshire, which got me involved in bringing organizing skills into that. Working with the Sierra Club on climate change stuff, like the Obama campaign 2007, where we got to introduce organizing to a whole lot of people through that campaign. And since then, through the campaigns on immigration reform and climate change and so on and so forth. So it turned out that this was just another organizing venue for me. And I'm really, really grateful for it because it sustained my learning, it sustained my engagement. And some of those students are here. Where's Kareem? Kareem, are you here? You know, there's Kareem Bardisi, who took the public narrative class, what, in 2006, 2007? Yeah, and is now teaching that here, advertisement, okay? Kai Young Park, where's Kai? Yeah, Kai. Kai's a medical doctor here who was at the School of Public Health 2 years ago, took the organizing class, came back and taught with me this fall in public narrative class. She's here in Toronto. If you want to learn public narrative. Who else is here? Kapil. Yeah. Introduce yourself. Yeah, but yeah, say what you're doing. Okay, so there's a hospital with organizing. Well, we'll see. I mean, maybe, you know, we hope so. Yeah, I don't know. Who else? Is there anybody else here? Is Jen here? Oh, she couldn't. Okay, all right. Anyway, it's kind of a cool thing. So that's how I come to be doing what I'm doing. So let me just stop there for a moment, take a drink of water, and what we're going to do now is talk about specific practices and skills. And how are you doing? You okay? All right, good. The way we teach leadership organizing, is around five practices. And the first practice is relationship building. Building relationships. Because organizing is grounded in the building of relationships based on shared values and the commitments to work together. Now, you know, there's a lot of confusion these days about relationships. And social media kind of has added to the confusion. Social media can be enormously valuable and helpful in sharing information and letting people know about things. But mobilizing a lot of individual clicks is not building relationships. It isn't. And that lesson was learned the hard way by our friends who mobilized in Tahrir Square in Egypt. A number of whom are students now at the Kennedy School. Very interesting to get a chance to actually learn from these folks who were involved in this, like this guy, Wael Ghanim, who was sort of Mr. Google, you know, and that. That's very interesting because, see, it was kind of easy for them to, there was a highly motivated situation, but they got the word out and got these numbers of people. Now, at one time, to turn out those numbers of people, you would have had to have a leadership structure. You would have had to have all kinds of organizational capacity. They didn't need it. Very cheap to mobilize over the internet. Very cheap. So they mobilized. Who benefited? Who walked away with the goodies? Did the mobilizers? Muslim Brothers, they had organization. The army, they had organization. And there's a scholar at University of North Carolina, a Turkish scholar who's been studying in Brazil and in Turkey, and these mobilizations that occur and they flash up and then they're gone. Because they're moments of mobilization, but they're not organization. Because they have no capacity for continuity, for learning, for strategizing, for follow-up, and for moving on through it. And so the foundation for that kind of work is in relationship building. It's in the recognition that you got interests, I got interests, you got resources, I got resources. Well, guess what? We could exchange those resources and we'd be both better off. And we need to have enough of a common value that we're motivated to do that. And then if we commit to one another, because, you know, it takes commitments to build relationships, and this isn't life counseling here, but you know, it sounds a little bit, yeah, like that. It takes commitment to build relationship, because commitment's what gives a relationship a future. It's like it's different from negotiating a contract or buying something. You know, you've negotiated everything, contract, it's all done. Relationships, do they work that way? You make a commitment to be in a relationship with someone. Do you find that it just stays about whatever the initial relationship was about? Or do you find it changes? Do you find it grows? Do you find you learn new things and they learn new things and new ideas come and new capacity? Relational commitments are beginnings, they're not endings. That's why it's so powerful. And that's why it's so fundamental as what organizing is about. It's about building those kinds of relationships and through those relationships building capacity. And it isn't just all about one-on-one. That's fundamental, one-on-one, learning about each other, each other's values. But, you know, it turns out that most people know other people. And if you ask people to bring people they know to their house, that's called a house meeting, not because it's in a house, but because they're calling people they know. And then you go and you meet those people, and what if two or three of them do the same? It's like a Tupperware chain, right? Tupperware parties. Now, that sounds, oh, that'll never get to scale. Well, it's how we organize the farm workers. It's how we built the organization for Nancy Pelosi in her first campaign in San Francisco. It's how we built the Howard Dean organization in New Hampshire. And it's how Obama won in South Carolina when all the established organizations were supporting his opponent, and we had to build something from nothing, and it was all through networks of relationships on the ground like that. So, number one is appreciating the significance and the value of relationship building as fundamental and foundational to this work. Secondly, challenge of the heart. You know, for people to move, it takes a challenge. You know, most of the time we operate on habit, you know, don't we? We're on autopilot most of the time. Now, to actually look at things differently, you know, to get a different take on it, it takes something to break that habit loose, all right? It takes something to break it loose, because otherwise that's where we stay. Now, see, our brains are organized for this. It's called the surveillance system. Here I'm talking to medical folks. And the surveillance system evolved over time to alert us to the unexpected. And so we're going along doing something on autopilot, and I'm driving my car, whatever it is, and all of a sudden a truck pulls out and I stay on autopilot. Well, that's not so good. And so my brain says, truck, 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 and I experience that as anxiety. And it's good anxiety because it gets my attention and I've got to rethink what I'm doing. And so often the first challenge we face in leadership is to create anxiety. That sounds kind of crazy. But it's a fact. If you want to challenge people to look at things in a fresh way, but that's not enough. See, you create a lot of anxiety, and then the default reaction to anxiety is what? What's the default? Shut down, run away, maybe it's strikeout, maybe it's freeze. That's also known as fear. Not the same thing as anxiety, fear. Not so constructive, pretty destructive, right? So we've learned through our cultures how to confront challenges in ways that challenge the fear. We've learned to develop sources of hope over fear, sources of empathy over isolation, sources of self-worth over self-doubt, and those resources, those emotional resources, are critical to, on the one hand, confront ourselves and others with the need for action and be able to respond to action with agency and mindfulness and not reacting and running all over the place. Now, one of the main mechanisms that we use to do that work is narrative. It's through storytelling. Because stories are structured in exactly that way. See, a story, if you think about what makes a story, there's a plot, there's a character, there's a moral. Three things, right? And I got up this morning, got in my car, gave two speeches, came here, talked to you. Is that a plot? What would it take to make it a plot? What would it take, huh? Like what? Flat tire, come on, a little more imagine. We were coming from the premier's office over here, right? And, you know, we're standing outside Queens Park there, and there was this noise, and it was this loud, kind of roaring noise. And then we heard a flapping. And then it appeared. It was a dragon. It was a green dragon that escaped from Game of Thrones and somehow seemed to be here. And here in Toronto, did you know there were? Okay, I'm being silly. But what's the point? Did it get interesting? See, what plots do, they create the moments of the unexpected. They create moments of uncertainty. And because we empathize with the character of the narrative, we experience that challenge, but we also experience how the character deals with the challenge. See, not as an idea, but as an actual lived experience, an experience of the heart. And so narratives, stories have been used, well, it's the first way we learned to communicate, to speak with one another, was through narratives, through stories, because they're a way to communicate the emotional content of experience, a way to communicate the emotional content, sources of hope, sources of courage. I mean, where'd you hear your first stories? Who'd you hear them from? Yeah, professional paid storytellers. Right. And what were they doing when they tell you those stories? Trying to put you to sleep. Now think about it for a minute. 85% of the time parents spend with young children is in storytelling. What's that about? What's teaching. You know, hey, there's Uncle Charlie. He started out right, but then he went wrong, you know, and then there's And then there's Aunt Harriet. She towed the line. And every family world over has these stories, and they are teaching. Jerome Bruner calls it their teaching agency. They're teaching young people how to access the emotional resources for making choices, because that's what stories are capable of. And same thing in faith communities. That's what you hear is stories, cultures tell through. So the point here is that one of the major categories, one of the major ways we experience life as human beings is in this place of having to deal with the unexpected and the uncertain. That's what the gift of agency is about. We actually get to choose things, but it's pretty scary. And we're infinitely curious about how to deal with it and what are the value sources through which we can do it. And that's where storytelling comes in. And so in the organizing context, we teach how to use the power of story to communicate to others why you were called to what you were called to, so they can get you. You're going to be in public life, and you're going to keep it a secret about why you're doing what you're doing? Forget it. You don't author your story, who's going to author it? John Kerry found out when he ran for president that his opposition was going to author it. So you have to claim authorship of your own story. That's an important piece. But then you also got to learn how to use story to bring alive value shared in the community that you hope to mobilize. You know, like the way people tell stories at a family dinner, reminding everybody of the values they share. And then there's turning this moment we're in right now into a challenge that requires a choice for which there is some hope of possible outcome. That's a story of self, us, now. That's kind of that piece. All right. Third, and that's about the heart. Obviously, talk more about any of these things. Third, strategy. Strategizing. So what's strategizing? We'll go to Greek, not Latin. Anybody know? Strategy. Strata was the word for a field, and it's a word for army. And the general was called a strategos. And the strategos went and sat on top of the hill, sort of, you know, here's the vision of how this battle is going to be fun. Won, and then the troops were deployed, and you know what the troops were called? Tacticas, right? That's strategy and tactics. That's where that comes from. Strategy is the theory of how we are going to achieve our goal, and tacticas are the activities or the ways we're going to use to accomplish that goal. It's way overcomplicated because people at the tops of organizations like to think, and like others to think, that they're the only people who can do strategy. You know, no, it's a real problem. And it's a real problem because then everybody else is supposed to be drones and implementers, and then there's these super people doing strategy somewhere that we don't ever see or know. But look, everybody here does strategy. You all strategize all that. Who had to strategize about something today? Yeah, you got lost or you ran out of gas or because we conceive purpose and then we get obstacles. So we got to re-strategize. See, and the definition for me is a very simple one. How do I turn what I have into what I need to get what I want? How do I turn my resources into the capacity or the power that I need to get what I want? That's it. You know? And a powerful social movement, powerful organization, they distribute strategy so that people are doing strategic work up and down. There's a 1986 article by Richard Walton in the Harvard Business Review, of all things, that distinguishes between what he calls control organizations and commitment organizations. And he says control organizations, they're for producing, you know, the same widget all the time, right? It's all about control. But organizations that are trying to do something creative, something innovative, something adaptive, they need to foster commitment. And commitment has to do with having the space to strategize, among other things. And so this whole thing about strategy and strategizing is something that not just a few people, but a whole organization, a whole movement needs to learn to do. And in organizing, the big issue is power. How do I strategize? How do I build power? And that's not so complicated either, frankly. If you need my resources more than I need yours, who's got the power? Let me ask it again. You need my resources more than I need your resources, who's got the power? All right, that's all there is to know about power. No. Because, you know, and if you flip it around, now here's the problem with that. If you need my resources, I need your resources, and we're both on the same level, let's collaborate. We can make more capacity. We're gonna make more power together. That's just terrific. But wait a second. If you need my resources more than I need yours, well, wait a second. Maybe I want to satisfy my interests at your expense. Do you think that might ever happen? Happens a hell of a lot. And so then the problem is, how do you rebalance it? And that's where you have to figure out how to do what the people in Montgomery did. You figure out how to combine with other people so that you flip the dependency. You flip the dependency. Then it turns out that dependency becomes interdependency, and then that enables you to deal. Very important to get this power thing. You know, it's something that's faded out of the conversation all over the place, and it's not too surprising because, you know, the people who have it turn out to not like to have lots of conversations about it. But it's not an otherworldly thing, and it's not an intractable thing. It's thinking creatively, understanding where the points of interdependence and dependence are, and then you develop a strategy, and that's kind of how it works. And the last thing I want to say about strategy is, you know the story of David and Goliath? Yeah? All right, you think you do. All right. Here, let me tell you. See, so the Philistines and the Israelites been you know, having at it for quite a while. And so the Philistine warrior, Goliath, big giant, he's sent to confront David, or to confront the Israelites. And he comes out, he says, I'm Goliath, and, you know, send your powerful champion to face me, and if I beat him, you're ours, and if he beats me, then we're yours. And what do the Israelites do? They're looking at their shoes, they've got to clean their room, and it goes on day after day, everybody's scared. And so this guy named Jesse sends his youngest son named David, who's a shepherd, he's not a soldier, to go take lunch to his brothers. And he arrives with lunch, and he's given lunch to his brothers who are warriors. And Goliath comes out, he starts doing his yomamas, or however you want to understand what it is that Goliath is doing. And at that point, David is outraged. This is an insult to the ranks of the living God. We got to do something. And his brothers say, shut up, kid, don't make trouble. No, but we got to. So he goes to the king, King Saul. He says, let me go fight Goliath. And king looks at him and laughs at him. He says, come on, he's been a warrior since his youth. You're but a youth. You're not qualified. You know, you haven't been to the University of Toronto, or you know, you haven't been at Kennedy School for whatever. You know, you don't have the experience. And David says, yeah, but I'm all you got, so you better take me seriously. So the king says, all right, I'll let you fight, but on one condition. You got to take my sword, my shield, my helmet, and put them on. You're going to need these to fight this powerful warrior. And so what happens then? David puts them on. He puts them on. And then guess what happens? He can't move. They're too heavy. That's when he looks down at his feet and he notices five small stones. So wait a second. I'm not a soldier. I'm a shepherd. And as a shepherd, I knew how to protect my flock from the wolf and the bear. And it wasn't with the sword and a shield. It was with a stone and a sling. Maybe Goliath's just another wolf, just another bear. He takes off all that armor, puts a few stones in his pouch, goes to face Goliath. Goliath takes one look. Am I a dog? You send a boy with a stick. Ha, ha, ha. Middle of the third, ha, stone in the forehead, end of Goliath. Now, it's not a story about nonviolence. But it is a story about strategy. And the point I want to make is, what begins the whole strategic process here? When does strategy start getting made in this example? When? What starts it? Huh? Yeah, but before that, what puts him on a track? Huh? I'm sorry? Challenge to the heart. Yeah. David's outraged. He's outraged. This is an injustice. Does he have a plan about how? Something's got to be done. He commits. Does he know how? Has he sent out to McKinsey for a 5-year strategic plan on how to defeat giants? Or BCG or any of those groups? No, sorry. But he made a commitment. He said, I'm here. I'm first step. Coming up with creative strategy is about making commitments, first of all. So then he goes to the king. He gets a conventional advice. You want to fight power? Well, you need what they need. You need what they have. You know, they got money. You need more money. You know, they got influence. You need more. Turns out to not be so great when they have more and when they're much better at it. And so that second point is about discover, what are your resources? What do you bring? What is it, your feet? Is it your skills? Is it your capacity for sacrifice, for commitment, for dedication? Those are all what the economist Albert Hirschman calls moral resources, and they grow with use. They don't deplete with use like economic resources do. Very, very different dynamic. Right? And then he goes to face Goliath, and Cesar Chavez used to say, power makes you stupid. What he meant was that when you're used to relying on overwhelming military, political, or economic might, you stop thinking. And that's what creates the opportunities for the Davids of this world. That's what strategy is about. It's creative. We can all do it. And it has to address the question of power. And it's got to be rooted not in what we don't have, but what we do have. You know, you come up with a great strategy that requires $10 million. Well, that's great. That's just terrific. What you got is people. What you got is heart. What you got is imagination. And when it comes to organizing and leadership and change, unless people are the fundamental resource of that change, you are not really changing anything. You're going from one dependency to another one to another one. And this is the challenge, is enabling people to find the resources with each other that they can take control of their futures. That's what it's about. And that's where the creativity and strategy comes in. Fourth, action. It's got to turn into real stuff. It's got to turn into real things. It's got to turn into real people in a meeting. It's got to turn into real votes if it's an election. It's got to turn into real cash if that's what you need. It's got to turn into real people walking off the job, real people disobeying a law if it's civil disobedience. It's got to turn into real action. Because that's where the rubber hits the road. Now, I was taught if you can't count it, it didn't happen. And the reason for that was, you know, it's kind of like, it sounds like real kind of a pain, right? We have a meeting and you had 8 people and I had 5 people and we just let that pass, right? No, we don't let it pass. How come you got 8 people, I got 5 people? Does that make you better than me? No. Well, what is it? What should I ask? What should I ask? How'd you do it? How'd you do it? What can I learn? See, unless you turn these kinds of actions into visible measures of progress or not, you can't learn. You're just stuck repeating over and over. But if you turn it into learning, you're all the time learning how they got the people to that meeting, why they showed up at that place, why they didn't. You have an enormous, but you got to get over this thing that reporting on numbers is somehow lack of trust or a devaluation or all the rest of this. There's a... Carol Dweck is an educational psychologist who teaches what she calls mindset theory. It's really terrific stuff. And because she sort of says it makes a big difference how you approach learning something new. And if you approach learning something new as an evaluation of you as a person, oh, this test is going to show if you're smart or dumb, right? This test is going to show if you got talent or you don't. Versus if you approach the same thing as this test is going to examine what you've learned. What you've learned. What do you think the difference is? What do you think the difference is? And the research on this is really interesting. What? Yeah.
Whether you enter with fear or as a challenge.
Yeah, you bet. And whether you got to defend against that fear of failure or whether your curiosity can learn from it. See, because if that's a test of how smart you are, oh God, oh geez, it turns out I'm dumb. Doesn't work very well. When you make things tests of a person as opposed to what they've learned, but when you put it in the domain of learning, oh, I got more to learn. See, the problem is that learning to do any of this stuff, it's like learning to ride a bicycle, okay? And how'd you learn to ride a bicycle? You study bicycleology? You got a degree in bicycleology? Or you watched a very compelling video, right? And then what happened? What'd you have to do? You had to get on the bike, and what's the first thing that happened? That's right, and that's the moment of truth. Then you went home and went to bed, or you found the courage, because it takes courage to learn to get back up on that bike, knowing you were going to continue to fall for a while, because it's the only way you could learn to keep your balance. That's how learning practice is. That is how it is. And so creating a space with the people with whom you work, in which failure is understood as information for learning and not judgment about who you are, is critical. Because then you can create a learning context in which people are going to grow in capacity. So action has a lot to do with learning. And the other thing it has to do with is commitment. And I want to just say one thing about commitment. I said commitment on relationships matter. You know, Irving Goffman, the sociologist, he wrote a piece called Face Work. And it's like, let's say we're having lunch. We're having lunch. And I see, with all due respect, you spill soup on your shirt. But I pretend I didn't see it. And then you see that I saw, but you pretend you didn't see that. And I see that you saw that I saw, but, and we engage in this conspiracy
to avoid embarrassing each other, okay? Because we don't want the tension. We don't want to deal with that, right? Now, how many times have you called on people to show up at a meeting and they say, I'll try, and you say, oh, that's a yes. It's not a yes. Why didn't you press it? Look, we got to know, you're going to show up or not? No, I mean, really, what are you afraid of? Oh, they might say no. Oh, my God. You know, the world's going to open, you're going to fall in the ground? No, what you'll know is what's working and what isn't working. You'll learn something from that, and then you'll have the right number of seats in that place when you... But it takes cutting through that tension, finding the courage to get through that tension, press the point, get a commitment or not. Look, this sounds like little details, doesn't it? But you know, Beethoven paid attention to every single note. That's how you achieve excellence. You pay attention to every single note in whatever it is you're trying to do, and it applies just as much to organizing and to leadership and to the stuff that we're talking about right now. And so these are some of the notes. Last thing, structure. Now, I say the word structure, and right away, there's a shiver goes through the room. Anybody react with shiver when I say structure? See, my generation had this big issue with structure, you know, because structure meant, oh, it meant this kind of prison in which there was an alpha, usually male, telling everybody else what to do, and you had to just do it. That's not all structure is or can be. But sometimes a reaction to a structure like that led people to say, no, well, we don't want any structure. We don't want any structure. We're all leaders here. We're what? That sounds great, right? Except Joe Freeman, the feminist sociologist, wrote a piece called The Tyranny of Structurelessness, because she said that in those circumstances, guess what? People are still making decisions. They're still deciding things, except you don't know who they are. And it's all about personalities and networks off the charts, and it's not. So the point here is, it's like telling your public story. You either take control of the structure, or it's going to take control of you. You choose. And so we've been working a lot with this question of structure, because it turns out unless you create structure, there's no space for creativity, for imagination, and for trying things, because you're struggling all the time. You know, 5 people showed up this week at our leadership meeting, 2 people next week, 8 people the next time. What do you build that way? You can never build any. I mean, imagine a soccer game, a hockey game, if every game a different number of people showed up. It doesn't work that way. So what we've been doing is we know a lot about what makes teams work in social science, and combining that with the work of leadership to create leadership teams. And the first time we tried this on a large scale was with the Obama campaign, 2007, at the Camp Obamas, where people came for training in leadership and organizing. And we organized them into interdependent leadership teams, explicit teams, bounded teams. You were on the team or you were off the team. Stable teams, commitment. Hey, leadership means you're going to be there at every meeting, not like, you know, your cat got sick. Well, I don't want to, no offense to cats, but whatever. No, I mean, you know what I'm talking about. It's like you're either going to step up and accept what it is and be honest about it or not. It means doing the work to define a shared purpose, which you find if you do relationships and stories, it's a lot easier to get there, a shared purpose. You know, norms, how are you going to govern yourselves? How are you going to make decisions? You don't wait until you got to make a horrible decision to decide how you're going to make decisions. You decide up front. This is how we're going to have consensus, or we're going to vote, or we're going to have whatever. How are you going to honor commitments or not? How are you going to handle time or not? It's just basic self-governance. And then you decide on roles and who's going to be responsible for what, for providing leadership in what, not just for following somebody else's orders, and you develop a leadership team. You know, that's how we did it. See, we were concerned about the problem. Volunteer efforts in organizations are often very fragile when they depend on a single individual. And the person burns out, or the person tries to, quote, hog all the power, or they think they're supposed to, or whatever it is. And what we discovered, if you could get rid of that as the idea of what leadership was, but rather you start out with the idea that leadership is interdependent. It means you're working with a team. And yeah, somebody's coordinating the team, and then people go out with the commitments to one another, you get more motivation, you get more continuity, it's more sustained, and it brings more resources. And my students sort of describe it as a snowflake, because kind of the idea is then each person on that team has their own, and then another team, and then another team, and you can sort of develop a distributed leadership structure through this kind of team approach. Now look, we're experimenting with this stuff because the old alpha model we know is broken, and we need something much better. And this collaborative stuff seems to hold a lot of promise because it engages everyone's resources to the extent that they can. And that is one of the things that actually, one of our takeaways from the Obama campaign was, hey, it works. You know, teams, you know, we had about 3,000 local teams in Ohio in that election because people bought, they actually had responsibility. You know, they had a responsibility to go out and recruit their neighbors and do all that work, but they weren't working alone. They were working in a team together and making progress. So if it isn't clear by now, the underlying then practice here in what I'm describing is leadership development. It's about creating the opportunities, doing the training, taking seriously the fact that people need the opportunity to learn, develop, and grow their leadership skills. It doesn't just happen. And you know, it's so, you see organizations as, oh, we believe in leadership development. Oh, you do? Yeah, once a year we have a retreat and we talk about, yeah, and then they go back to business as usual with one guy telling everybody else what to do. Well, that's not, see, leadership development happens in the work. It happens in the way you do the work. It doesn't happen in a seminar somewhere. And if the work is structured in the way I'm describing, then you get leadership development. That's how that stuff, now look, it's not easy. And I sure don't mean to make it sound easy. But I want to stop right here. And let's open up here and let's have a conversation about some of this stuff that I've been talking about. What do you think about this? What sort of questions do you have? What's on your mind? I've been preaching the gospel here, but I want to hear it. Yeah. Yeah, and maybe if you stand up and speak very loud, it'll help.
One of the things that I've been thinking about recently is there seems to be a lot of public uprising and passion around issues like climate change is one. Here I work in healthcare. Healthcare for refugees is another one. Like a lot of people mobilizing, a lot of good arguments, and no change from government. Yeah, I'm just wondering
What do you think?
I don't know. I mean, I guess it's not strong enough has been a question that I've been asking myself, like, what are we missing? What's the step that we're not taking? Because it seems that, you know, like millions of people marching in New York or all of the healthcare organizations of the country telling the federal government what they're doing is wrong.
Now, are we talking about Canadian federal government or American federal government?
No, I'm mixing both.
They're really different.
Yeah.
Let me just say, they are really different.
Yeah, it's true, yeah. But I guess for me, I see it as, you know, I think it's a good fight. I think people have the right information. There's a lot of people behind it, a lot of passion. There are leaders, but I don't see change.
Any ideas here about what's missing? Yeah, here. So he's got the answer here.
In terms of the climate change, actually the march in New York and also global-wide, I think it made some difference. Just last week, China and the U.S. signed agreement and called a commission. I think that's something. Without that march, I think probably it won't. So okay. Canada is another story. Our federal government is kind of like a dragon, I guess. We need to get rid of, I think. So that's what we need to make change here to press, you know. Thank you.
The China thing is kind of, there's a great book, by the way, by Naomi Eskes called The Collapse of Western Civilization, if you haven't read. It's a very short little book, and it's written from the perspective of a 23rd century Chinese historian who is looking back to try to explain what happened. What happened? The failure of liberal democracies to step up to the climate change challenge. And it is a big and very, I don't have to tell you how serious it is. Now, so what do we do about it? Well, so theory of change. See, a theory of change is at the heart of strategy. It's like, what's my hypothesis? See, that sounds like, you know, it's very theoretical. But that general up on the hill, he's got a hypothesis about how this can affect that to produce that. Now, Bill McKibben,
who does 350.org and who helped organize the, you know, the march with the 400,000. Bill's got a theory of change about the role of universities, for example. So universities are major institutions. They have some moral responsibility as well as being economic actors. They're supposed to be places of education. So how come they profit from fossil fuels? How come? I mean, now I don't know how it works here. I know how Harvard works. Harvard makes a lot of money off its investments in fossil fuels. Now, is that going to solve? So ultimately, the fossil fuel industry is the problem. Not the whole problem, but it is a big piece of the problem. I know in the States, the amount of money that they invest in TV commercials, in political campaigns, it's obscene and it's horrible. It's not like accidental, that, you know, this climate denial stuff. I don't know how much it's reached here, but it's a big deal in the States. It wasn't just an accident, something happened. These are these companies that do. There was a great piece in the New York Times about 3 weeks ago of a meeting in Colorado of one of the DC consulting firms with a bunch of the fossil fuel industry saying, well, you got to play dirty if you want to win this thing. And somebody taken a tape recorder in there and recorded the whole damn thing and gave it to the New York Times reporter. And it's just, you know, these are the things we kind of suspect. But no, that's the deal. So we have an industry that's dedicated to perpetuating a problem that's killing us and going to kill us. All right, so what do we do about that? Well, divestment is one strategy. That's a plausible pathway. Boycotts might be another pathway. Legislation and tax policy might be another pathway. There isn't one single pathway, but we've got to figure out how to focus our energy and effort. You know, and it may be that different parts of the community focus on different things. I mean, I think the divestment campaign at Harvard's a really good thing, because it challenges the university, it educates a lot of people, it identifies part of the problem. Now, I know there's other perspectives on all this, but it's my point is that you got to come up with a theory of change. That is, okay, if I do this, what do I think it's going to do? How is it going to produce something? Now, if we can reduce the production, you know, fossil fuels, if we can get rid of coal as a source of energy, that's going to accomplish something. Now, how do we do that? Well, again, different pathways, different strategies. It's not going to happen with people just deciding they're going to change their light bulbs. It's something more. We had a session, I don't mean to go off on this, but I was privileged to have a session a couple of weeks ago with the Dalai Lama at MIT. And with three of my colleagues, it was all about climate change. And it was about how to make real, see, one of the problems in the climate change movement is the urgency. It takes urgency to act, right? It takes urgency to shake us out of things. And when there isn't urgency, but only importance, it's not enough. And so there's something called moral urgency. See, when students had sit-ins in those lunch counters, they created urgency. You got to do something. When the students at Harvard in 2001 sat in the president's office there around living wage, they created urgency. Saul Alinsky, the community organizer, said, organizers got to be well-integrated schizoids because you got to polarize to mobilize and depolarize to settle. And that's right. But it's the kind of urgency that can be created and focused that begins to get people into action. There's a great group in Massachusetts called Moms Out Front. And it's a mother's organizing effort because their notion is that they're responsible for their children's future, and their children's future is at risk with all this climate stuff. And so they're working in the community level, getting people to switch to green energy sources, counting how many we get today, At the city level, institutions, the same thing. At the state level, on legislation, same thing. So the point is that this is not out of reach, but we got to tackle it. And I really appreciate the question, because change needs to happen. And let me say, it's a lot more your generation that's going to have to deal with the consequences. So you have a particular responsibility here, I think. Not that those of us who made the mess are not responsible. We are. But I really appreciate the question. Yeah. Oh, over here. And then we'll come over there. Yeah.
Hi, Marshall. Thanks.
Hi.
The concept of organizing is really compelling for me, especially for justice. Like when you talked earlier about social justice and economic justice, political justice. And I wonder, as someone who I think comes from a place of power, of privilege, and probably we're at U of T, so I'm guessing that applies to most of us here in this room. If you have any advice or cautioning on how we engage and what kinds of roles we play constructively to help achieve justice for racialized communities and other marginalized communities, playing roles that are respectful and appropriate, but still very constructive and maybe leverage, you know, unique opportunities that we have, or if you could just comment on maybe your own experiences with that and where you went right and where you went wrong, or.
Yeah, I'm curious about why privilege is a burden. No, wait, don't go away. No, why is it a burden and not an opportunity?
I think it can be both.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What does it take to make it an opportunity?
Advice.
What do you think? No, what do you think? I'm curious. Because you obviously have a concern that has nothing to do with privilege, unless I'm confused. What do you want to do something about?
Lots of stuff.
Yeah, well, what are you thinking about when you ask me the question? What are you thinking about in particular?
I mean, I've been working on the issue with healthcare for refugees, and that one's a bit more straightforward because I'm also in the sort of medical field, so you can kind of use that as an in with, you know, patients that you encounter, and that's sort of your. So maybe it's the relational thing that you talked about. It's about building relationships.
That's certainly one. That's certainly one piece.
Mm-hmm. It's very participatory.
Huh? What? No, I missed that one.
This is very participatory.
Oh, yeah, it's very participatory. Yeah, that's what this all is, very participatory.
Took a lot of courage to ask
no,
the question.
No, it's good. It's good, yeah. It's great.
Does anyone else have any ideas?
That's great. No, thank you. Look, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I do, because, no, it's a red herring. It's a red herring. Look, if you know, one of my favorite characters, organizer character, is Moses, okay? Now, why? Well, he's of the oppressed, but he was raised in the house of the oppressor. I mean, he was raised in Pharaoh's house. It was very confusing for him. You know, when he discovered that, he didn't know how to handle that. He got outraged. He killed somebody. He had to go off in the desert, which is where you go in the Bible when, you know, you're confused to figure stuff out. And eventually, you know, eventually he comes on this bush and it's burning and all this stuff. And he decides the inside-outside perspective is critical to social movements and social change. Dr. King was from a privileged black family in Atlanta, three generations of Baptist preachers at the largest church in that city, got his PhD in theology at Boston University. What does he have in common with a plantation worker, except for color? A lot of privilege. But the decision then to take the opportunities that privilege creates for you and to turn it into a resource for service and for engagement, well, that's a good thing, isn't it? That's a good thing. And any community I've ever worked in, people are pretty pragmatic about, see, when it's all words, it's all theoretical. When you get down to doing the work, people need and want what they need and want in order to make change and get things done. And the basic deal that I was fortunate enough to learn in Mississippi as a white guy going down to work in the black community from Harvard, you know, I mean, come on, that's like, yeah, I had great mentors. A guy named Hollis Watkins runs something called Southern Echo still in Mississippi. A guy named E.W. Steptoe. Who helped me learn, here's the deal, respect. You respect people. You do or you don't. People know, you know? And then you listen. And then you ask lots of questions. And you learn. And you pay attention. That's all what you do. It's not so complicated. When there's powerlessness, everything becomes complicated because everybody's trying to attribute it to some reason other than themselves. But when you're in the work of building power, people feel the change. People feel the efficacy. They feel the fact that their circumstances are changing and they want more. And if you can be an instrument, if you can be an ally, if you can be a collaborator in that, more power to you. So I really think this is something not to get hung up on. It can be a real barrier. You know, it's as if privilege and I don't know if people like Foucault, but you know, this whole idea of power is just something that's there. It's not like that.
Power is, it's constantly moving, changing. It depends on resources and capacity. And so, I don't know, that's my sermon.
Did you guys hear that?
Thank you. No, but thank you. Thank you for the question. I really appreciate it. And really think about it. Yeah, over here.
Yes, I think it's my opinion that Moses was a wounded healer living in the Pharaoh's house realizing his roots. There's a field of study called agnothology, is the study of culturally induced ignorance or doubt, particularly the publication of misleading scientific or medical data. Agnothology focuses on the deliberate fomenting of ignorance or doubt in society. That's what the cigarette manufacturers did, spent billions of dollars trying to mislead the public, and the climate change money spent trying to fool us all that there's no such thing.
Okay.
These
Thank
people
you.
With the power.
I didn't know what to call it before, but now I know. Thank you. Yeah, because it's sure out there. It's sure reality. Over here?
I was a lot of what you're talking about.
Tell us your name and who you are.
Sure. I'm Roland. A lot of what you're talking about is like kind of transformational change. I was hoping you could speak a bit more about what your thoughts about incremental change.
Well, what do you mean?
I mean, I look at something, like two examples that come to mind is the Catholic Church and the Republican Party.
Whoa, wait. Okay, now these two small examples. All right. Now, yeah, okay, I'm interested. Are we talking about transformation or increment? What are we talking about?
No, well, I'm interested in, I think, you know, there's a huge emphasis in today's society about transformational change, protesting.
Is there really?
I think there's a huge emphasis, at least that's what I see.
Okay.
But there isn't a lot of talk about incremental change and getting your foot in the door and gradually making change over time. So that's, I'm kind of interested in hearing your thoughts about
that. It's really interesting because I have a really different perception of it. I hear forms of incremental change put forward all the time as these things take time, do a small thing. And the problem, it's not big or small. The problem is whether you're really trying to get at the problem or not. See, and let me go back to the bus boycott example. If in that bus boycott example, they had succeeded in desegregating the buses. Look, that's just buses. Talk about incremental, right? That's just buses. Not the whole system of institutionalized racism and all the other stuff involved. But then you say, how do you tackle institutionalized racism? I don't know. But now, if they'd desegregated the buses with a lawsuit, what would they have achieved? They would have desegregated the buses. But by desegregating the buses through an organized community effort, what did they do? They shifted the power. By the end of that campaign, that community was organized. That became a power base. They developed all kinds of leadership. They developed capacity for moving forward. So see, I don't think you can dodge the fact that these challenges are structural, a lot of them. A lot of them are miner's canary kind of issues. You know miner's canary? You know about the miner's canary? You know, they take the canary down in the mines because if there's poison, then the canary keels over because of its weak respiratory system, and so the miners can get out. A lot of, you know, the people who are most vulnerable in our culture, our societies, they're miner's canaries. They're revealing something wrong in the system. You know, it makes a big difference whether you look at something as whether it's a bug or a feature. And I don't know if you've read Piketty's new book on capital. People read Piketty, that's a very important book, because he argues that inequality is not a bug in capitalism, it's a feature of it. Which means that if you're going to deal with it, then you have to put in place the kinds of political mechanisms to make that happen differently. So why would you be satisfied with incremental change when there's a big problem? Wouldn't you want to make incremental change in a way that it's not just incremental, but it's laying a foundation to get at the heart of the problem? And I don't mean to put you on the spot on that, but I just think, look, if we're going to deal with these things, why don't we deal with them? They need to be dealt with. So I don't know. That's my pitch.
Thanks.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hello, Marshall. Hi. I'm Sam, and I want to thank you, first of all, for being here and for the history that you were able to share and to experience.
Thank you.
I find that one of the issues that I observe is that there is a segmentation of socially minded people with various issues and approaches to those issues, and that there isn't a leadership that has been found to grab all of that segment and pull it into a unified or unified collaborative approach. Because I suspect that everybody who's here, or almost everybody who's here, is here because they are interested in the social fabric of the country and the place that they live. And they're interested in participating in a, quote, change, unquote. And I'll give an example. I was attending a Council of Canadian Toronto chapter meeting 3 weeks ago, and there was a presentation that was given by a representative from the Ontario Health Coalition. And their key mission is to ensure that the existing healthcare structure of Ontario remains unprivatized. And they came to a meeting that only had some 10 people in an attempt to engage those 10 people, as you describe in the collaborative method, to go out and engage more people. The speaker certainly grabbed my attention, and I went to them and I, by email and phone, said I was prepared to offer them help. Well, unfortunately, by phone all I got was messages, and by email I got no response. No. So you have this desire to go out and find people, but the failure to actually execute on the action part that you described.
Yeah, well.
So since there is this diversification without this ability for finding a way to blend or bring them into a concerted power, you had that obviously occur in 2008 when you were involved with the Obama campaign.
Yeah, we had a moment.
So how do you, because a lot of those people had their own issues.
Yeah.
Some of them wanted, how does one bring those diverse groups together?
Yeah, I don't know, prayer. I mean, but I do think there's this. One of the things we discovered in Obama 2007-08 was enormous fragmentation by issue. It was sort of like, we're the this issue, and we're the that issue, and we're the this issue, and people defining themselves by their issues. And so then you imagine, you look at a room full of issues, not people. And I can't do, and what we what enabled us to do that work in that campaign, that it was around values. It wasn't simply around issue. It was about values cutting underneath those issues that had to do with inclusiveness, it had to do with equality, and it had to do with the need for power on behalf of those things. And so, people came together in that setting around a shared values agenda with a very specific strategy, which was mobilizing the country to elect the first African-American president, and in that way, begin a process of change. Well, we built a very powerful organization. We had 1.5 million people. Unfortunately, when the president was elected, the president decided to govern not by mobilizing support for change, but by trying to accommodate and trying to minimize opposition. And so, from my perspective, we blew a golden moment of re-education of the American public. But we did a good job. So now, decouple it from electing a particular person, put it in service of a movement, and then you can build a movement. Do I know how? No, I don't know how. I don't live here. You do. Figure it out. But see, don't let this issue thing trap you, because there is a deeper affinity on a lot of these things that have to do with core values. And powerful movements and organizations transcend.
They find a way, and narrative is one way to begin at get at identifying what those core kinds of values are. Because otherwise you get issue-fied or whatever the word is, fragmented off. But, you know, how do you do it? Here? Now? I don't know. But, you know, be like David. Maybe you'll figure it out. I mean, no, really. I'm not being flippant. I mean, you don't figure this stuff out without diving in and figuring it out. There's nobody, anybody says, I got the answer, forget it. They don't. Over here.
Hi there, Marshall. My name's Stuart. I'm an organizer with Toronto 350.
Hi.
Hi there. My question is to sort of ask you about how I'm doing and what I'm about to do, which is to invite all of these lovely people here to join us in organizing on the divestment campaign that Marshall was talking about a few minutes ago. We've had the campaign for a couple of years, and we're at a point now that university's formed a committee to consider it. We had a rally last week with a couple hundred people out on campus. And we would love anybody who's feeling inspired about organizing, which I'm sure is all of you, and I'm sure you're all already organizing and stretched really thin, but come out anyway and join us, and let's make the divestment happen in Toronto. How did I do?
Let me ask you. You got a good applause. This is kind of good. Where's your sign up? Where are you going to get them to sign up on?
Can I ask the other 350 members in the room to stand up? Come on, guys. And there's one guy over there, Sam, right,
now,
Ben, Trezanne, and Katie.
Now, who's got
myself?
The pieces of paper with name, email, and so? Oh, okay. Now,
come and talk to us afterwards.
Who's going to begin just passing them down the rows right now so that you can collect them when people leave and not wait till the rush, okay? Little tiny details. When you got them, nail it, you know, close the sale. But no, I appreciate that. But good. And is there a particular meeting or time or place where something's going to happen?
We meet every Tuesdays, 7 o'clock at Steelworkers Hall.
You got a specially urgent and important and critical meeting coming up that all these people need to come to?
We do. In fact, this week we actually have a potluck, so it's even better to go to.
Oh, it's even better. Okay, good.
And that one's at my home, so you'll have to find the address from me. So talk to me afterwards and start forming those relationships.
Well, and the cool thing about potlucks is if you accept responsibility for the salad and you don't show up, there's no salad. So it's kind of a way of distributing responsibility all the way around. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi. I have chills because what you're saying is so powerful. And the first experience that I had with the snowflake model was one of the first times in a lot of years that I had hope. And I work on climate change. Ah. And so... I'm actually a pipeline organizer with an organization in Canada, and I have been doing, kind of immersing myself and failing and falling in organizing over the past sort of 8 months. Quick plug, if this stuff is resonating with you and you're excited about it, next Friday and Saturday there's going to be a... No, this is totally related. There's going to be a progressive organizing conference happening in Toronto with a bunch of the people who've been doing this, and it's working, including pipeline organizers in BC, including, well, this maybe didn't work so well, but some of the organizers around the recent municipal election, a couple of the mayoral campaigns.
Well, they maybe learned a lot maybe from that.
Yeah, well, exactly, right? Talk about some of the ways it didn't work. Canroots.ca, it's based on Roots Camp in the United States, which I know you're familiar with. And so please come talk to me afterwards. I'm very sparkly and I'm wearing black pants. My name is Sabrina. But my question is this.
I actually have a great question. So, we actually need a notice board or something.
I know,
people leave.
This
yeah,
is
yeah,
what
great.
You've done. My question is this. I'm partway through your book, and I also work in an organization. And one of the things you talked about in your story around the farm workers was the experience with other unions and how their attitude is quite different from what Chavez was doing with your group. And I wonder, I guess my question is, I'm looking at how we are doing organizing in Canada and how the desire to mobilize people and the desire to make change, like I work with so many good people, but organizations, is there hope for organizations to be able to give up that top-down sort of power structure and the structure, you know, the stuff you're talking about? And is there hope for our organizations, and I work for one, to really participate actively in this kind of organizing? Because I think it's the only thing that's going to work, but it's challenging, you know, it's very challenging for unions and organizations, et cetera. So.
No, I think it's a great, great question. I think Pope Francis is facing a similar challenge. I think right now, going back to the Catholic Church and the Republican Party, I don't know what happened there with that, but No, look, it's not so much about whether it's a union or not. It's like organizations become established, they institutionalize, which is often the result of earlier successes, and then the problem comes when the accountability drops out. The problem comes when they're able to insulate themselves against ongoing challenge for change. I mean, universities are a great example. My view is that unless students accept responsibility for challenging the universities they're in, the universities don't change. But see, the university is great because they got new people coming in all the time, and so there's an opportunity there. Now, when organizations can insulate themselves from those kinds of challenges, and those kind of, then yeah, they ossify, and it's a big, huge problem, and they sort of get stuck within. So then the question is, how do you open that up? How do you create organizations that are more open? How do you legitimate dissent, for example? I mean, this is a real challenge in organizations. Is dissent is not disloyalty. Dissent is actually really constructive. Do you have a devil's advocate? Do you deliberately arguments for, arguments against? Oh no, we want consensus. Well, wait a second. Consensus can be a real way to marginalize difference. It's a silenced dissent. I mean, I that may be heresy to say that. But the idea that we've all got to agree on everything in order to be able to act, that's not so great. You know, the Jewish tradition that I come from is one that preserves arguments. You know, in other words, the minority views, the majority views, the Talmud is a whole commentary of different arguments. And it's very interesting because the idea is that you preserve the minority view because later that might be the right one. Because the premise is that no human being can have the whole truth. And so you always need to preserve other perspectives. Now, look, there are different ways, but I think tackling how do we keep dissent alive, how do we create mechanisms of accountability and change internally? There's no easy answer to this, I don't think. You know, I really don't think. Sometimes people have to sort of retire and then get replaced. But that is one of the dynamics of generational change. And generational change is a big driver of change. And you know, people come along, they have a different perspective, they have different experience, and they change the organization. Then there's organizations that are careful to select young people that are going to be just like them. That's not so good. So I'm just sort of saying, yeah, but let's, you know, it'd be interesting to talk in a very concrete and specific way how to make a strategy with respect to a particular institution. And think about how do we mobilize the sources of change. We had a whole discussion today with somebody from the Service Employees Union who's talking about exactly this question, who's been trying to develop a new model of community engagement, a lot of resistance from the people who've always done it the one way. And so how do we create a space over here where we can do something new and then create enough tension that we can draw the old into the new? But that's the work it takes. So good luck. Yeah.
Hi, Dr. Ganz. Thank you for your presentation. My name is Selena. I'm from the School of Public Policy at U of T. And my question is about, the labor movement in recent years, we've seen a lot of really inspirational examples of community organizing, bottom-up and worker-led organizing, like the Workplace Project in Long Island or the Coalition of Immokalee Workers in Florida or the Our Walmart Project. But simultaneously, we've also seen the globalization of labor, you know, the vertical disintegration of supply chains and, you know, the presence of temporary foreign workers in our agricultural fields. And so I'm wondering, do you think it's possible for us to organize both locally and globally simultaneously? It's really easy to say, let's act local and think global, but is that truly possible? And in what ways has organizing really responded to these trends?
I think it's a really interesting question. You know, Adam Hochschild wrote a book called Breaking These Chains. I don't know if people know that book. It's about the anti-slavery movement of the 18th and 19th century, the first global, trans-local movement, originated in England, moved to the States, to France, all over. It's really interesting to read how they leveraged country against country, how they built these different bases, how they maneuvered at a global level in the 19th century. You know, Gandhi's whole strategy was based in large part on organizing in India to mobilize opinion in Britain. The civil rights movement organized in the South so as to be able to mobilize support in the North on the federal government to use it to pressure the South. ANC, Mandela's people, organized in South Africa so that they could then create ground for a divestment campaign around the world of sanctions on South Africa. And the Palestinian movement is trying to do something like that now through their BDS campaign, is trying to do something like that. In the farm workers, we couldn't win in Delano, we came to Canada. My point is that it isn't, you know, there's no automatic separation between local and, you know, you go where the power is. And you figure out, we used to, in the farm workers, we were really happy when we had some big corporation because we could attack it in all these places. It was like an octopus. We had what we called the fishnet theory. If it was a little fish, it could get through, but if it was a big fish, we could catch it. Because there were so many points where we could get at it in different ways. So, you know, it's not a new thing. I mean, yeah, sure, the companies, corporations, they're going to do everything they can. Well, we got to do our part. And look, we got medium of communication that didn't exist before like this. Capacity for coordination didn't exist like this before. So we got new tools, new capacities to use, but we got to figure out how to use them and how to use them strategically and in a focused way. But there's plenty of examples. So look at those and think about, okay, how do we bring that to bear on whatever the particular challenge is? Does that make sense? Yeah, you know, history is really cool. No, I mean, cases, you know where you read, Caesar was so interesting, Caesar Chavez, because he read everything like a manual. You know, when I met him, he was reading Winston Churchill's books because he had studied Gandhi and he wanted to learn how Gandhi's opponent thought. And so he was reading Churchill. He wanted, you know, there's a way to read examples, to draw on examples, and there's a lot of utility in that. You know, for learning how people deal with some of these struggles and have before. And sometimes things that seem brand new aren't so new, it turns out. And there's a lot of times that old ideas trigger new ways of thinking. So there's learning to be done here, you know? This is a great opportunity for learning, for peer learning, for you know, the resources it takes to create real social change. You know, the Bible lessons were a great thing for the civil rights movement. Learned a lot about power from Moses. But anyway, over here.
Hi, this is a more of a tactic specific question. Yeah. Where I'm also working with the divestment campaign at U of T.
Good.
And we have a problem where there is someone in an administrative position of power who can very specifically give us what we want. And I think this is a recurring thing through other campaigns. And they're, for the most part, a passive ally. And they've given us a timeline. They say, well, we're going to examine this for 1 year, and then we'll make a decision.
Yeah.
How do we... So we're using divestment as a tactic to up urgency on climate change. How do we up urgency on divestment without pissing off these people who, for the most part, agree with us?
Yeah, you got to be careful about this. We don't want to piss them off. You got to be really careful about it. You want them to respect you, not like you. There is a big difference. There is a huge difference. See, it's not about pissing people off or not. It's about demonstrating their interest or not. You know, it's about dealing, and it's sort of like, yeah, they're a nice person, and I yeah, they said this, and then you graduate, right? No, I mean, I've got
3 more years.
Oh, well, okay, well, you're in good shape.
I've got time.
No, but you know, Gandhi said a deal without a date is not a deal, okay? See, setting deadlines are ways of creating priority. Mm-hmm. See, and we need an answer by X date. Well, but we're being really nice and we're talking to you. But we need an answer by X date because then we have to take the next step. You know, time is running out, you know? Well, but we're really nice and we... Well, yeah, fine. Yeah, we like you too. And we hope you like us. But we need an answer by this date. See, it's what we were talking about earlier about commitment, calling the question, not fearing the tension, not being crazy about it, but being very clear and firm about it. And we used to have this guy with the farm workers say, he was great. He could meet with some, you know, supermarket chain or whatever and say, now you have by X date to decide if you're going to take off California grapes. And you know, you can decide. And after that, you know, then pickets will appear the next weekend at 25 stores. And then, you know, if another week goes by at 50, now I'm not threatening, I'm just describing the consequences of a choice. And see, you can think of it in terms of cost-benefit analysis. It's like, it becomes, when it becomes more costly to resist, right? When it becomes more costly to resist than to cooperate, they cooperate. When it becomes less costly to resist, they don't. Now look, I know it's not as simple as that, and I know there's good people all around. But the bottom line, when you're dealing with institutions and organizations that operate based on interests, which they do, you need to really understand that. And then the calculus is, how do we raise the cost or diminish the cost? The students at Harvard that did that sit-in, boy, they, see, but they spent 3 years building support for the living wage thing in the community. They had like 800 faculty signatures. They had all these students. They'd built all this, and the administration was doing nothing. And so then they said, okay, X date, occupied the office, we're gonna stay here until this is settled. It took 21 days, they won. Now that's not to say it always works that way. They were very smart in polarizing after they built a base, right? So they didn't get marginalized, the administration got marginalized because they built this broad base of support. So, you know, it's all about strategy and tactics, but really I appreciate the question you asked. And I think about respect, not liking, and think about clarity, and think about the way in which time creates priorities. Because, you know, they got lots of things to do. Oh, we can put this off. No, you can't put this off. This got to be dealt with next week. Oh, it goes up on the list. Mm-hmm. And then you begin to maybe get some action. And also, just the last thing I'll say on that is anything, anything that's disruptive, no, anything that creates, that requires an organization to do stuff it doesn't usually do, is costly. See, it's like, oh my God, now we got to spend all this time dealing with this problem over here, but we have all these other problems. And so now how are we going to do that? There is cost involved simply in distraction. So really think about what kinds of resources you have to inflict cost. And I don't mean that in a violent way, but to make things costly. See, because really what you're trying to say, look, it's very costly not to act on climate change. So all we're trying to do is make real how costly it is. Mm-hmm. Moral urgency. Great question. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, over there.
So good evening. My name is Chris Ramsrup. I'm with Justice for Migrant Workers. We organize temporary farm workers here in Ontario.
Oh, great.
So great to meet you finally.
Good to meet you. Yeah.
Cool. So I guess the first question I have, and then it's about the UFW, the farm workers. And if you could share some of the lessons learned from some of the mistakes that the UFW made, So you know, just a few. And I just was wondering if also, just for the audience, just a question about boycotts. And I just wanted to clarify that with boycotts, it's not basically all of us in this room calling for the boycotts, but it's for the people who's most impacted, that they're the ones who are calling for the impact. So I just wanted to clarify some of that. And I know sometimes that when we think about organizing, whether it's refugees and healthcare or with temporary foreign workers, a lot of times it feels futile. And especially when government policies goes against us. But remember, it's about those changes that are happening, the fact that we're raising consciousness, that we're bringing people together, and having the people who are most impacted trying to fight for change. So yes, government policy may not go for us, but the fact that people are coming together to fight on the ground, that's what's making the difference, and that's what's leading to change. Okay. So I just wanted to say that.
Thank you. And I think I'm looking at the time here. I'm not trying to dodge the question here. Yeah, we screwed up some things in the farm workers. I think, let me just say in response to that, we failed to institutionalize internally an effective mechanism for internal accountability. We allowed power to become too centralized. We allowed power to become too concentrated in one person. And you know, as human beings, we're just not equipped to handle that. You know, we're not equipped to handle lack of accountability. None of us are. We get into moral trouble, we get into political trouble. We allowed that to happen. And it really is what crippled the organization. So that's a longer conversation, a longer discussion. But this whole question of accountability, change, making that balance is really important stuff. And so I think that's all I can say on this right now. But read my book, and I'll tell you.
I'm so glad you put in a plug for the book, Marshall. And I'm sorry to the last. Okay, I was getting, I think Marshall's getting tired, so why don't, if we can make your questions really fast, that would be great. I don't know if you do.
Marshall, your perspective as a university professor, so many students go into school to give them the tools to organize and tackle social issues. But unfortunately, there's so much student debt and the cost of education is so high that it often cripples them organizing the future. So maybe if Harvard tuition was as expensive back in 1964 as it is now, you wouldn't have the time to take off a year and go to Mississippi and dedicate yourself to that. So how do you see that balance? Being a professor, people want to go to school to learn these skills, right, but also the it cripples organization at the same time.
Got it. And let's get the next question too.
So my name is Sarang. I'm an organizer here in Toronto. I've been studying your work for the last 4 years, and it's been a real, very valuable resource on your online materials and videos. So thank you for making that available online. My question is similar to the gentleman who asked about bringing people who are working on various issues together. Mine is more Toronto-focused, but different communities. You look at Toronto, we're a very diverse community. We come from around the world. We're a city of immigrants, and we're also a city of many refugees from across the world. So when you are, and I just kind of came off from 8 months of campaigning in the municipal election, trying to elect the first women of color as a mayor, but we didn't succeed. But in that, doing that work, what I've learned is that trying to organize in a city like Toronto, it's almost like trying to organize the world, because people who come, we have a lot of new immigrants in our city, so that means those communities are very tied to their own community struggle of how they came to Canada.
Sure.
So when you're working on a city issue, on a municipal election, and also, also you look at, for a diverse city like Toronto, you look at the power structure and you look at the demographic of the elected officials and people who are in position of power, that we have a lot of work to do. Yeah. It doesn't reflect the Toronto that we see in on street.
Right.
So my question to you, just coming out of the campaign in the last 8 months, working across the city, and we use the snowflake model trying to build neighborhood team leaders across the city and canvassing and building those teams. But one of the biggest challenges was trying to bring those different communities together to focus on our municipal election on things that, issues that actually affect everybody on a daily basis. So how can we, you talked a lot about finding that common values. So my question to you is, for a city like Toronto, how do we find that common value, common ground to open up the gate to share our common values?
Well, just like this. No, I'm not going to. No. Look, number one, it's about relationship building. And it doesn't happen overnight. Because each of those communities has their own concerns. They have their own reality. They have their own struggles. They have their own leadership. And if you are going to try to seriously bring leadership together across a lot of communities, don't expect to happen tomorrow. I mean, it takes a lot of effort in terms of creating relationships to begin crossing some of those boundaries and creating spaces in which the work can be done, in which people can define common concerns. I mean, coalitions are fine in theory, but in reality, it takes a hell of a lot of work to make something like that work. In Boston, we have something called the Greater Boston Interfaith Organization. It's a faith-based community organization. My friend named Jim Drake came there to organize. He spent the first year, he had 2,000 one-on-one meetings that first year, figuring out the community, figuring out the different churches, the different faith traditions, the different, and sort of trying to find who are the people here who have leadership who could become a core for this kind of thing. Now, when they had their first public meeting in Boston, they had 5,000 people, and it was the most diverse gathering anybody'd seen in Boston, which is not exactly a racially progressive place. My point is that you can do it, but it takes a lot of work, and it takes a lot of time, and it takes a lot of focus on trying to find the common grounds, and not trying to go under the leadership, but trying to engage the leadership in the work. At least that would be my thought about it. So I don't know how helpful that is. That's sort of saying, yeah, go back and work for another 5 years. But, you know, on the university, look, I've been advocating in the States a moratorium on student debt. And I think everybody should just stop paying. I mean, it's not going to, in the States, now I can't speak to your circumstance, but in the States, it is an obscenity what
to put in mortgage the future of your community by mortgaging the future of young people, that's just crazy. I mean, it's suicidal to sort of introduce all these reasons why you can't take risks when you're young and can take risks and can try new things and say, no, I have to pay off. So I don't know, I've been advocating, look, I mean, Elizabeth Warren, our senator from Massachusetts, is great, and she's on this issue. I don't think anything's gonna happen until people really on a large scale just stop paying. And I can say, oh, but my credit rating and all that. Well, I don't know, this thing's gotta come to a head. In the States, it's gonna take something pretty drastic, I think, to bring it to a head, because it's insanity what we're doing right now. And not just from the question of social justice, but like research. Who the hell wants to do the kind of research work and the creative and innovative work when you got to pay off all this? Anyway, I take your point. I don't know how you're going to do it up here. Good luck.
Amazing. So my name is Danielle Martin. I'm a family doctor and a VP at Women's College Hospital, one of the sponsoring organizations this evening. And I've been asked to do two things. First, to say a few very important thank yous, and secondly, to very briefly maybe try to find a thread in the extraordinary things that we've heard from Marshall this evening that links back to the work that our hospitals as sponsoring organizations are doing, and particularly for a faculty of medicine trying to put doctors out into the world who get what it is that you're talking about. Firstly, I want to thank Dr. Catherine Rouleau, who was the instrumental person in bringing Marshall to speak with us tonight, in addition to Kai Park, who offered the introduction, Jamie Rodas and Paula Ruiz for their work to set this evening up, because as you all know, it takes work to organize something like this. So thank you. And you know, Marshall, it occurred to me as I was listening to you speak, and I think we were all incredibly inspired and motivated by your words, that really what I heard you describe is that the craft of organizing is about taking people who are driven by really big ideals and convincing them that accomplishing those goals comes down to one door at a time, one house meeting at a time, one conversation at a time. And in a way, that's sort of what we do in medicine, right? Is we deal in the one-to-one interaction in an attempt to try to make the world a better place. And I think just as so many of the people that you were describing had difficulty translating their big dreams to that one-on-one interaction, sometimes we have a hard time understanding that what we're doing in the one-on-one doesn't mean very much unless we're also trying to advocate for change at the broader level. So it's almost like we need bifocals to be able to see up close and then far away at the same time. And I think the challenge for all of us together as a community is, do you wait for the rare individuals who can see both of those things at once, or do you try to build coalitions of the people who have the gift for the big vision and the people who understand how to make it happen at the one-to-one? And I think that is, in bringing together groups like the ones who organized and participated in this evening, that's a first step towards building that kind of what we'll call maybe the bifocal association. So thank you very much for this extraordinary presentation. I think we were all really inspired and moved by it, and we know you've had a tremendously long day. We hope you're going to get at least a decent meal out in Toronto tonight. Thanks for coming.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I like the bifocals. No, it's really true. It's like that general. You got to be up on a hill to see the whole thing, but you got to be down in the valley to see the reality. And how to be both places at the same time is really challenging. But that is where the creative space is putting them together. So thank you so much for that. Thank you. I think yes. No, let's applaud. I think the time is now. So I thank you, Danielle. Thank you, Catherine. Thank you, Kai. Thank you, most of all of you, for engaging in this conversation this evening. Not so much for what you have done, but for what you will do. And in that spirit, I want to conclude with a song. But I won't sing. In the fourth grade, they told me, please just mouth the words. And so that was sort of the end of that. No, this, you know, yeah, it's pretty mean, actually, you know, think about that, yeah. But, well, I like singing, but this was a song Judy Collins recorded, and, you know, the Civil Rights Movement never called itself the Civil Rights Movement, it called itself the Freedom Movement. It was much more ambitious and broad in its vision of change and transformation, which goes to some of the points that were made here. It wasn't about changing some legal statutes. It was about a different vision about how to live life. And it's in that sense that she recorded this song. And it goes like this. Freedom doesn't come like a bird on the wing, doesn't fall down like the summer rain. Freedom is a hard won thing. You have to work for it, fight for it, day and night for it, and every generation has to win it again. Pass it on to your children, brother. Pass it on to your children, sister. They have to work for it. They have to fight for it, day and night for it, and every generation has to win it again. Pass it on to your children. Pass it on. Thank you for the opportunity to pass some of it on. Thanks. Thank you.